know, tonight.
Memduh, what about you?
I'm flying. You know, it's 6 o'clock in the morning, is it? To Istanbul tomorrow. So I don't know if it is today, tomorrow, given the time difference especially.
Yeah, so you're terrible. I mean, you basically get to spend the night doing whatever you can.
Exactly. It's because, you know, my time, it's around probably 2:30 a.m. that it will take off. So it will be different.
This is my complaint about Turkish Airlines. Their flights, even from Bahrain to Istanbul, it's a 4 a.m. flight. And they built it for the connections, because to me, I would shift. It depends. I don't know where how it works, but you know, you can have multiple banks, as they call them, and things. But you know, if I'm going to some of the smaller. To go to Istanbul,
yes.
It's much easier because it's 3 hours and then 2
yes,
hours.
Yes.
So it becomes, it's just too tiring.
It is. You're right, probably it's for the connections that they have these.
I hope you had a restful night.
Yes.
But it's
as much as
great airline. Istanbul is a lovely city.
Considering the time lag. The time lag is
the
connection.
The thing is, if it's a connection, do you stay at the hotel?
No, usually it's just 2-3 hours.
London is 4.5. But the trick I always find is that you just go to the gym,
so from
get yourself
to
all
Bahrain,
tired,
it
then
what?
Go take a hot
3.5 hours.
That's
coming
good.
Was 3 hours.
That's good.
Maybe 3.5 to 4 hours.
When I travel, that's why I do that. Evening,
actually,
after land,
I
really walk
to
the gym.
But it's actually 5.5 hours. Psychological thing, as you fly more and more, it becomes accessible. I mean, Bahrain is, how many was it? Is it 5 hours?
From
Istanbul.
No,
is it 3? I think you might have had the dialogue.
Yeah.
Is it 3 hours?
Yes, sir.
Then it's nothing. It's very close.
But they need to wait to check like that.
Geography.
Yeah. No, it grows big when you.
Okay, I think we'll start.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're all the early birds. I'm sure others will trickle in as we progress. Monday morning itis, as I call it, second day of a conference after a night. Unlike yesterday, we are a bit behind schedule. My apologies for starting 10 minutes late, but we have a comfortable day ahead, and we'll make sure this session gets the full time it deserves. Just one announcement, and I will repeat this later, which is that after lunch today, from 3 to 4:30, we have a special session called on the Geo-Economics of Global Pharmaceuticals. It's in a smaller room. Those of you who attended the cybersecurity session would know the room, Chaitya. So it would be good if during the coffee break, those of you who would like to attend that session, let the registration desk know that you'd like to attend, so we have an idea of how many would be in that room, and in case we need to put in some extra chairs, we'd be able to do that. But I can assure you it would be an interesting session. We have some very interesting speakers even in that session. So make sure that you register your names. Well, welcome to the third plenary. This is, in some senses, the core of geoeconomics. In many ways, global geopolitics has been driven over the last 2-3 centuries by the geoeconomics of commodities, the search for energy, the search for minerals, the search for metals, the search for other natural resources has defined a lot of geopolitical activity for a long time to come, in fact. And therefore, it's quite natural that in a conference of this sort, we should try to get a closer understanding of what is happening in the world of commodities. Our three speakers this morning have an interest in a range of commodities, but also in the geopolitics of regions where commodities are important. We have the former finance minister of Chile, Dr. Felipe Larraín, Bascuñán, also a member of the IISS Council. Sheikh Mohammed bin Essa Al Khalifa, the advisor to the Crown Prince. Forum from Turkey. I will not take your time introducing them. Their biodata are in your folders. Let us, we'll begin with Mr. Bascuñán, and then I'll invite Sheikh Mohammed, and then my friend Memduh. Mr. Bascuñán.
Good morning. I would like to first of all, thank IISS for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. Let me just say that I use, just to get out of the confusion, my last name is not Bascuñán, it's Larraín Bascuñán, but I use Bascuñán because of my mother, who always asked me to use her name with my family name. So it's Larraín. And I would like to make probably 5 points. The first is the difference between oil and other commodities. There is certainly a decline overall of commodity prices, but it's a relatively moderate decline of commodity prices in general, but it's a very important and steep decline in oil. So there's a big difference between the two. And the if you look at the last 3 months since June, oil Brent was $115 a barrel in mid-June. It's about $82 today. The WTI was $96 in mid-June, and it's about $78 today, roughly, or by the end of last week. What are the reasons behind this? Supply reason is U.S. oil production. U.S. oil production has increased by about 80% since 2008, so it's not double, but almost double, and this is due to some new techniques, the fracking that we know, so that the daily production in the U.S. Has increased over 11 million barrels. The U.S. has overtaken Saudi Arabia and Russia as the world's main oil producer. This is, you know, for the first time, and U.S. investments in the oil sector have topped $200 billion and will top $200 billion in 2014. On the other hand, there are some interesting issues happening here. The decrease of Saudi Arabia has reduced oil prices for the U.S., but has increased oil prices elsewhere. And you know, this is like a perfect discrimination, and you can do that, you know, this is perfect price discrimination with Saudi summit coming on November 27th. There are also, of course, it's not only the U.S., but there are other producers, Libya and Iraq, which are also increased production. This is supply side consideration, so huge increase in oil supply. What happens to demand? Demand is relatively weak because of low, subdued European growth on the one hand. On the other hand, the deceleration in China, which has, you know, the pace of increase of demand has slowed down because of mainly these two reasons. So we have supply-demand considerations. And is this, are we about to go in a slump of commodity prices? I don't think so. The case of oil is different, as we discussed, but there's no, probably no slump. If you just look, China is growing at between 7 and 7.5%. This year, probably between 7.3 and 7.4. This is about 2 percentage points less than China used to grow. But India is picking up. And the very important issue, if you take not just the case of oil, but other important commodities like copper, you know, is urbanization rates. And that's a very important point if you want to analyze commodity markets. Urbanization rates currently, as of 2013, are 52% in China and 32% in India. Well, this is only... prospects for 2050 are that urbanization rates will be in China close to 70%, in India close to 50%. So there is a very interesting evidence in terms of when copper demand, what happens to copper demand when urbanization rates go over 30%, copper demand accelerates. So there's a different thing here in terms of copper and oil. From 2003 to 2008, during that very short period of time, the overall commodity price index, calculated by the IMF, tripled. So you have a 200% increase in commodity prices over a period of less than a decade. This is unprecedented. This is more than you had after the Industrial Revolution, which is the other super cycle of commodities. This is actually the third super cycle of commodities. Industrial Revolution, after the Industrial Revolution, pretty much second half of the 90s, and after World War II, slowdown of the super cycle, but probably not in a slump. We're not in the edge of a cliff. China will likely keep growing. There are better prospects of India and the rest of Asia. Many countries are having prospects of not only growth but also urbanization. During this process, it's very interesting to consider what will happen within the commodity bundle to different commodities like let's say you have minerals, metals, and you have agricultural commodities. This will behave differently, partly because what you will see from China at least, and in some other countries in Asia, is a shift from investment to consumption. Right now, out of equilibrium. This is an unbalanced composition of demand, that you have 34% consumption, 50% investment. You need to have much more consumption, and you will have this through increases in wages and the appreciation of the yuan and the renminbi. This will have implications. Consumption with urbanization is different than just, a huge investment spurt that will be heavier on metals. Consumption will be heavier on goods like, agricultural commodities and for minerals and metals. My fourth point here is the winners and losers of this. Is this a zero-sum game? No, it is not. It is not a zero-sum game. It is a positive-sum game, at least from the reduction of the price of oil, because there is, the estimates of research are that with a 25% decline of the price of oil, if it is sustained, the world economy will grow by about half a percentage point more. So you have an increase in world growth, all other things being equal, of about the decline of oil prices. Different countries, of course, will respond differently. That's the overall for the world. There's a recent calculations that if you're an exporter of oil, of course you are about to suffer, and you are suffering right now. And for countries like Iran, you need oil at $136 a barrel to sustain, to have fiscal balance. In Venezuela and Ecuador, so there are, of course, these countries are in the red. In Nigeria, it's about 118. In Saudi Arabia, it's 92. In Kuwait, Qatar, and the United Arab Emirates, it's about 70. So very different countries are in very different situations. There are a few countries, and I would point to Iran, Venezuela, and Ecuador, which will be highly complicated by this decline of oil prices. Where will the winners be? Well, the winners will be in the manufacturing sector and in agriculture. Countries which are net oil importers and are heavy on agriculture and industry will have to gain. The US is probably the main winner of this in this balance. Then you have probably Japan, India, say that although Peru, some countries in Latin America will also win from this combined higher decline in oil prices than decline in minerals and metals. My final point is, where are, if you consider this situation, well, you are, were you just endowed by God with commodities? And, you know, the question is, what did you do when you had the commodities? And I will point to the importance of fiscal institutions to cushion countries from the cyclical effects of commodity prices. The typical thing in a heavy natural resource-based economy is that the fiscal budget is highly dependent on commodity prices, both directly through the ownership of natural resources and indirectly through tax revenues that are charged on companies you know, that are in the natural resource, are in commodities, and also the general economic activity. Then it will, you know, it will pick up very significantly all levels of economic activity, construction, transport in a given economy. So there is good commodity prices for a heavy natural resource producer are a good thing. In the good times, what did countries do? And this depends a lot. If you just spend the windfall that you got from commodity prices, then you will be in trouble. If, on the other hand, your fiscal policy is tuned to the long term, if oil producers, oil exporters have, many of them in the Middle East, in Asia, have sovereign funds, have important sovereign funds. So if you establish the sovereign fund, then you have saved for a rainy day. And, you know, if oil prices go down, then the governments can tap into this sovereign fund wealth. Do you have the other question? And the experience is very... it's not only having a sovereign fund, is your fiscal policy tuned to long-term structural revenues, or are countries just spending out of current revenues? If a country just spends out of current revenues, then it's going to have a very pro-cyclical effect. So when the cycle goes down, then you have to adjust government spending. If, on the other hand, you spend according to long-term revenue, then when the cycle goes down, you just run a higher deficit, but you will be able to cushion the effect on demand. So what I'm saying is that countries, and particularly emerging countries, because you know, this is partly, you know, an emerging market issue, not only the day of reckoning. You know, when the good times, everybody looks good. When things get a little more complicated, then there will be very divergent trends, and I will quote here to finish Warren Buffett on emerging markets. The same will happen with commodity markets and countries, you know, with, as with financial markets. When the tide is high, everybody looks good. When the tide goes down, you can really see who's running, who's swimming naked. Thank you very much.
Excellent. I think that sets the tone for the session. As I said, the link between the geopolitics of what is happening around and the geoeconomics of commodities is so obvious from what Mr. Larraín Bascuñán told us this morning. I'm sure there's been some concern in India in recently about what commodity prices, the collapse in commodity prices, which you, I think, very interestingly said, is not a slump but a phase, has had both positive and negative effects for India. across different commodities, and that has been an area of policy concern. I'm sure there would be questions on that. But there are also issues relating to the geopolitics of Russia and Iran, countries you mentioned as being affected by the decline in oil prices. So thank you very much for those very interesting thoughts. I now invite Sheikh Mohammed bin Essa al-Khalifa, advisor to the Crown Prince of Bahrain.
Sanjaya. Think together. Maybe three of the 5 points Felipe just mentioned are in my points as well. So excuse the similarities, but we are talking about the same topic here. I tried to present a Gulf perspective of commodities, and that being oil. So my talk will primarily visited with His Royal Highness the Crown Prince. He had an official visit to the state of Kerala. And for us, this was important. 70% of the Indian community in the Gulf is from Kerala. And it was the first high-level ranking. He was the first high-ranking official from the Gulf to visit Kerala. And for us, it was, almost looking through a looking glass, Kerala as a subset of India, and India by 2028 will become the most populous country in the world. It's as more people begin to live in cities, and the urbanization Felipe just mentioned, earn gives you a sense of how India is changing and becoming more important in global oil demand, and for us this is it is one of the key factors going forward. And also to put some perspective, this trade in commodities has been going on for thousands of years, and especially with us in the Gulf. Traders from India used to go to Mesopotamia and in modern-day Iraq 4,000 years ago. And along the way, they stopped in Bahrain, maybe mainly for water, not exactly a commodity, but an essential part of life. And we've had these links over the years. These links today probably our biggest trading element is hydrocarbons with India. It is definitely a key part. Countries like India, China, Japan rely on oil to create, to fuel the growth. But one of the key essential elements that all markets look for is price stability. Price stability allows decision makers to make better assumptions, for finance ministers to better manage state budgets, and it helps businesses plan future costs and revenues and make better decisions, and it also helps individuals plan future disposable income and housing, and their expenses. And over the past decades, Saudi Arabia has played a big role in becoming, as the swing producer in OPEC, in helping stabilize oil prices. When oil prices plummeted in the 80s, Saudi Arabia cut production and helped stabilize production, stabilize prices. At the same time, Saudi paid a cost. They lost market share to new non-oil non-OPEC oil producers. At the same time, as we all know, Saudi Arabia has also increased production when a gap occurred in the market, be it in Iran or Libya, or whenever there is a global need. The Saudis always have stepped in to help stabilize oil prices. And even more recently, even when Iraqi production began to come back on stream, Saudi Arabia reduced its production downwards to help maintain price stability. And as my colleague Felipe mentioned earlier, as we all, I guess, sober up from the ecstasy of China's double-digit growth over the past years and the demand is dropping. In North America, oil prices have hit this multi-year low, and people think the prices will come down. An interesting role in cutting prices to America, and this has affected not only the price of oil and oil or the share price of the large oil companies such as ExxonMobil and Chevron, but it's also dragged down some of the commodity prices of or the prices of other commodities such as sugar and corn. Now maybe they're linked to making ethanol and things like that, but it still has had a positive impact. My premise is a price war is not in anyone's interest. Maintaining price stability is something we should all work to. Having established exporters and new exporters race one another to the bottom is a scenario that in the long run for the global economy does no one any good, because what we need is moderately low but stable oil prices. And as Felipe mentioned, it lower oil prices will help increase global growth. So, you know, we're in almost a global prisoner's dilemma, establishing, you know, old technologies versus new. What we need, and excuse the cliche, we need a global solution for a global problem. And as you know, we have the OPEC meeting coming at the end of the month. Maybe it is the start, and maybe some messages can come out of it. You know, yesterday we were talking about by an additional 2%. Commodities, I believe, will be a growth target, and maintaining moderately low but stable oil prices will help everyone and will help the world achieve that target. So for us, we need to find a way to create and turn this global prisoner's dilemma into a win-win situation. I agree that it isn't, you know, so there is sufficient demand to support oil prices and prevent a complete collapse. But we need to play our cards right and maintain stability for the long run. And, you know, I'm a believer in that the 21st century is the Asian century, and us in the Gulf are part of West Asia. People keep referring to us as the Middle East, but I like to think of us as West Asia, you know, from Japan on one side to the Gulf on the other. We are part of this growth story, and we need to, as we did trade several millennia ago and have been trading ever since and growing, we need to continue this growth. Help in Asia. Once again, thank you very much for the IISS, and look forward to an engaging discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheikh Mohammed, for a fascinating presentation. I'm sure there'll be lots of questions based on what you said, particularly whether the current decline in oil prices, which you assured would not result in a slump because there is sufficient demand, whether this is strategic or tactical, whether it's in response to what is happening in the United States, the growing energy independence, as America refers to, or it's to do with Russia, it's to do with, as you put it, a new relationship with rising Asia, that you see yourself as West Asian rather than Middle East. They're all very interesting issues you've raised as you've reinforced your own commitment to price stability. I now invite my friend Memduh from Istanbul, Memduh Karakullukçu, President of the Global Relations Forum.
Thank you. Good morning. Let me start, of course, by thanking IISS, NORF, and most importantly, Sanjaya Baru for organizing this conference and inviting me. I don't think anyone in this age who seriously thinks about the globe can overlook India in any dimension. And India is certainly not an easy country to comprehend. So I really am grateful to our organizers for giving us the opportunity to think more closely about this great country. Following my exchanges with Sanjaya, I'll focus on two commodities today, natural gas and oil. Probably there, and maybe I'll just add something on the margins, but I'll at least try. I think in both cases, natural gas and oil, dynamics with different time horizons are superimposed on each other. So it really makes it very difficult to disentangle the various dynamics. So I'll make an attempt to take them apart, hoping that I can provide some clarity to what at least looks a very complex problem to me. Given the time limits, I'll have to simplify and overlook, obviously, many details. We can get back to them in Q&A. Let me start with natural gas. Commodity, we know it. Gas is a commodity traded across the globe in very large volumes, but it is not a global market. It is still predominantly a fragmented market defined by geographic proximity and pipeline trade. Because it is a vital commodity for most economies, and in many cases, the importer and exporter are captive to each other, natural gas creates the perfect context for applying economic leverage in the service of political ends. It is a perfect subject matter for geoeconomics. In the bigger global picture, Russian Federation sits at the center of the natural gas geoeconomics. In terms of reserves, it has the largest proven reserves, although BP seems to think that Iran may have as much. Still, I think the general consensus is that the Russian Federation has very large volumes of proved reserves. And then it's Iran and Qatar are following with their high volume of reserves. And in terms of exports, by far Russia leads, followed by Qatar and Norway. And the ratio between Russian exports and Qatar and Norway exports is almost 2-to-1. So the Russian Federation is the critical player in the politically charged gas trade. And its key partner in gas exports is Europe, especially in terms of revenue, which accounts for much more than half of its gas revenues. And for Europe, looking at it from the other side, Russia provides consider Norway out of Europe, but if you consider Norway as part of Europe, then that ratio of 30% goes up to about two-thirds, nearly two-thirds of its imports. And this is predominantly pipeline traded gas. So what we have is an almost perfect case of mutual dependence between a big supplier and a big importer. And when the Ukrainian crisis erupted, this long existing interdependence assumed a heightened level of visibility and significance. In the immediate future, both sides seem to be careful not to disturb their gas trade, as neither is capable of substituting an alternative for each other. Russia needs the income, Europe needs the gas. And there is always the possibility of Russia leveraging its power, but it has used its leverage mainly vis-a-vis the Ukraine. Nevertheless, in preparation for such a contingency, recently Europe has filled its storage facilities to the hilt, and with the LNG facilities, it can withstand a cutoff for some time. And that resilience varies across countries. However, at the moment, I think the standoff looks stable as both sides try not to perturb this tenuous balance while trying to punish each other through other means. The interesting question about the geoeconomics of natural gas trade arises when we look at the implications of the crisis in a longer horizon. Will the crisis their bargaining position vis-a-vis each other? For Russia, the best bet is to find alternative markets in the growing Asian nations. And in this particular case, it proves to be mainly China, because India still seems to be difficult due to geographic and political barriers in building the pipelines from Russia to India. So as one would expect, Russia has recently signed a 30-year deal with China for a 32 BCM per year gas deal worth $400 billion in total. The price agreed was lower than what Russia was asking for before, reflecting a at least around probably 5 years, and the annual planned volume is still much less than the volume that Russia exports to Europe, but it can be scaled up. Even this arrangement of finding an access, a new export market to China is not perfect for Russia, because the Chinese gas will mainly flow from East Siberia, not from the sources that currently supply Europe. So it is not really substituting one for the other. It would have been ideal, and it would make Russia a swing state if it could just find a way to use the same sources and sort of, sell the same gas to both markets. That would allow Russia quite a bit of leverage in gas trade, but that doesn't seem to be on the cards. So the China deal is the Russian side of the attempt to shift the bargaining position. For this strategy to work in the long run, what you need is these two big importers, big markets, Europe and China, not to have alternatives to Russia for the foreseeable future. As it happens, there are two important developments in the global gas trade which really puts that Russian strategy into doubt. First is the expanding LNG trade, which weakens the geographic dependence on pipeline suppliers. Already globally, about a third of gas will probably gain momentum, mainly because Europe will now seek ways to expand its options. Similarly, China is about to access LNG supplies from Australia in the very near future. The second development relates to shale gas. Although we mainly talk about shale in the US context, shale is actually geologically, very broadly spread around the world. So once the technology spreads, we'll probably see many countries around the world, China included, most importantly, that will start accessing shale gas. The rise of LNG and the geographically spread shale gas can and will most likely provide alternative supplies to these two big importers and weaken Russia's bargaining position. So basically, trigger the fault line between Europe and Russian gas relation, with major implications for the geoeconomics of gas trade. It seems to be a race against time between Russia's attempt to diversify its export markets to Asia on the one hand, and EU and China's access to gas supplies through LNG or shale on the other. In my opinion, although there may be a short window of time where Russia enjoys a strong hand in this race, in the medium term, underlying forces of gas trade are likely to favor globalized markets and will weaken the power of exporters. One final wildcard that needs to be mentioned is Iran, which has the second largest gas reserves in the world. And if the negotiations on the nuclear issue are successful and Iran joins the global gas trade with its ample supply, the era of strong gas exporters and using gas exports as instruments of political leverage will probably. Of course, the surprising news about oil is the low price. Why did it happen? I think my colleagues have provided the answer that I had in mind. But one thing that I should note, the excess supply that we are talking about is really around probably 1 or 2 million barrels a day and can be reversed due to a disruption in Iraq, Libya, Nigeria, or even Venezuela. I mean, the world is full of those cases. So what went down can easily come up. One should not assume that the oil prices will stay where they are. And then the next question is, of course, does not seem to show an intent for cutting supplies at this stage. Then the other issue of U.S. suppliers, the light tight oil producers may feel the $80 is not worth the effort. They may withdraw. But even when you add those up and you look at IEA analysis, there doesn't seem to be much of a very large volume that will be cut off because of the $80 price for oil. Now, if supply crises don't happen, demand does not rapidly pick up, or suppliers do not deliberately cut supplies, then the low oil price may indeed last a while. Then the question is to think about the repercussions. So what happens? Let's assume we stay at $80. The immediate impact looks positive because it will add, as the minister said, probably about 0.5% to global GDP growth, which is most welcome given that the US QE is coming to an end. Also, low oil prices will hurt some globally assertive economies like Russia and Iran that rely on oil income. The Russian reaction is hard to foresee as it will closely interact with Russian domestic politics, and you know, it can go either way. It may lead to a conciliatory tone or an incendiary tone, I don't know. On the for their government budgets. This is especially true for countries that do not have accumulated reserves to withstand the low oil income. Nigeria, Venezuela, Iraq, as the minister counted, are some, and there's Ecuador, some obvious examples that we would need to watch for the impact of financial stress on social stability. Of course, such disruptions to production in those countries could then lead to the reversal of the low oil prices that we are observing. Low oil prices may even survive such instability in fragile oil exporting countries, potential supplies around the world, so that might just offset the disruption which may or may not occur. Finally, thinking about the possibility of low oil prices for an even longer period of time. So let's assume that despite all the potential crises, still the oil price stays at the $80 level. What does it mean? Now, low oil prices, we know, deter investment in new oil production, which leads to long lags in production growth. The supply eventually falls short of growing demand and causes unduly high oil prices a few years down the road. So, because if the investors feel that it will stay at $80, they stop investing, and a few years down the road, we don't have enough supply, and the price sort of shoots up. This is especially relevant because at the moment, because of the sanctions in Russia and Iran, already investments for potential supplies are being cut back. And then because of the political instability in places like Iraq and Nigeria, there are, again, considerations of cutting back potential investments. So we may be at a stage where all these forces are coming together to withhold potential investment for future oil production. So despite, if we have this $80 for a while, a few years repeatedly discovered low-cost light oil supplies around the world, or other low-cost supplies, you know, in places like Mexico, could sustainably increase supply and preempt such a price hike. But that is hard to predict that stage. And of course, oil price that remains at low levels for too long will make it very hard to fight climate change through efficiency gains or development of new technologies. Ideally, oil price should hover around a level that will provide a boost to the global economy while not deterring new investments in oil production. Unfortunately, oil markets rarely strike that perfect balance. And as the oil price fluctuates through these dynamics with different time horizons, it will impact global politics and will shift and recalibrate economic power around the world. As long as the world depends on fossil fuels for its core energy needs, we seem doomed to be at the mercy of this volatile interplay between energy economics and global politics. I will stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Memduh. I think what is fascinating is that all our three panelists have a similar perspective on the immediate future of commodity prices, that while they are low, they are unlikely to remain low for a variety of reasons, and that while price stability is an ideal, it is unlikely to prevail, and we will live forever with these ups and downs. I know we have who are experts and energy, and I've Mr. Soumitra Chowdhury, member of the Planning Commission in the previous government, who has also spent most of his last 5 years in government thinking about India's energy policy. And there are others, so I'm pretty sure we'll have a lively interaction from the audience. I invite people to raise their hands, but I'm going to first invite Sanjay Joshi as one of my co-organizers of this conference to respond. Yes. Francois, I'll come to you after Sanjay.
Thank you, Sanjay, and thanks to all the three panelists for a very engaging three presentations. I was just going through the news as this was rolling out, and yesterday, another framework agreement with China, and this one is for, it's a framework agreement, 30 BCM of natural gas, and guess what, from the Western route. So this is an interesting development. It's still yet the news report says that this is going to be gas supplies are expected around 2019. And Alexei Miller, of course, has made a statement saying that by 2020, we hope that Russia's supplies to China shall be larger than the supplies to Europe. So we read it as a definitive political statement in the background of the Ukraine crisis. And I'd love to hear the comments of the panelists on this development.
Yes, Francois. I'll take three or four interventions and then come back to the panel.
Thank you. I really enjoyed all of the presentations and was particularly attentive to what you were saying, Mr. Karakullukçu, on the prospects on the oil market. And if we have a nuclear agreement with Iran later on this month, and I think the omens are getting better as the days are passing, which is sort of unusual because we are getting very close to the deadline. Iranian production had, so there must be a lot of low-hanging fruit out there, and that could have an impact on the market.
Mr. Mashal.
I'll ask Memduh, since you are in the center of all these issues, and leave geoeconomics, how political these issues are. We're looking at it economically on all aspects, but even I mean, when I've heard the agreement of Putin and China last night, the only thing I thought of is it's a political agreement. It's not really anything to do with economics. We have problems in Syria. We have problems in Iraq. We have problems in the Ukraine and Nigeria. These are all oil-producing countries. Taking history, and if we look at it in the past, every time there is a problem, a political problem, we see prices are neutralized. Prices are, if it goes down straight, Saudi will go or OPEC will go reduce. They will keep the prices in a neutralized level. This time, nobody's complaining. Nobody's saying anything. The demand is not really increasing with the low prices. That's why it makes me come back and say, is it really political? And all these issues are treated as political issues instead of economical issues. Thank you.
Mr. Chaudhary?
Yeah, I mean, sort of similarly on the same question. You know, you have a hurdle rate which is very conservative when they were assessing any production, at a much lower order. Because there's always the suspicion that this price is not going to hold. So I don't know how much production is actually vulnerable from a lower oil prices. For example, Bakken, which is the light oil, tight sands oil, Bakken is coming out of the ground at $42 a barrel at the wellhead site. So I don't know how much production it will threaten and how much E&P will threaten. What has really seemed to have happened is the forward markets for oil has collapsed. And it's essentially the forward markets which kept the spot up and at a level which sort of was rather high. I think producers saw this as rather high an opportunity, but I don't know how much they bet on it. That's one half of the question. Therefore, I think that's a backdrop that I don't know how the panelists will react to that. The second part of it, how long is it going to last? Because as Mr. Larraín mentioned, various producer countries have various pain for 1 month, 6 months perhaps, but for how long? At some point, it's going to become unbearable. A country like Nigeria and the Central American countries have historically been unable to take pain for very long. It's been Saudi Arabia has got a greater capacity. But now there are many others, and how long will they take that pain? How long will they continue, let us say, to cooperate in this regime? How long will they say, till Saudi Arabia, we're going to going under, so you better do something? That's my question.
Thank you. I'll now come back to the panel and then go back because I have several people who have raised their hands. Mr. Larraín, would you like to respond to?
Sure. I think some of the questions were more directly linked to oil, but let me just start with the last point. I think countries are at very different levels of the pain they will take, you know, and how will they react. In my own region, Venezuela is probably the country where you can have a most severe effect, you know, more than Ecuador, although they look like they are, you know, in a similar way. Venezuela is having a big political and economic crisis, and this could add the last push that they needed to get a social or political explosion in the country. So I think that in some particular cases, this will be very, you know, Venezuela did not accumulate anything, you know, at the time or the good times. So I think Venezuela is one case, but there are many others. On the other hand, although if we take, of course, this panel has been dominated by oil, but there are other commodities. There are other countries which, like in the case of my own country, you know, a small country, Chile, but we depend, we are the largest world exporter and producer of copper. And we, since 10 years ago, about 10 years ago, we started to establish a fund, you know. So if copper prices go down, and they have come down, but they have come down less than oil prices. So we are suffering, but, you know, but not suffering that much, and we can still tap on the resources. So, and we have a fiscal policy, and Peru is in a similar way. Peru and Chile are very similar economies. Peru, slightly more diversified. Chile, you know, more dependent on copper, but both highly dependent on copper. So it depends where you look. The other part that I would mention, and I post this also issue to the panel, to my fellow panelists, is the fact that we are discussing oil here, you know, but as if there were, you know, very few substitutes. And we have an increasing amount, an increasing getting not only have been, like, particularly in the U.S., is going from oil to natural gas. But let me say, there is another part which is very important, and it's, you know, what has happened in solar panels and photovoltaic cells over the last, let's say, 5 to 8 years. The price of photovoltaic cells has declined by 2/3. And what does this matter? Well, this makes solar energy more competitive. In our, in the case of countries in South America, where we have, and there are many countries which have a supply of solar energy, we have one of the best places in the world, in Chile, the Atacama Desert. And there are billions of dollars of investments in solar energy that by 2020 or 2025, we don't know exactly, we'll have about 20% of our energy needs will come mainly from alternative, renewable energy, non-conventional. We will do more. How about the new hybrid cars, electric cars, which will likely by, you know, 10, 20 years, you know, be a very important and dominant factor in the automotive market. And last but not least, I think that there is something that we have not talked. It's a more difficult issue, but it's the fact that in many countries we're spending, according to some sources, OECD sources, for example, about $500 billion a year on energy subsidies. Well, I mean, countries are getting strained on their finances on energy subsidies, you know, and if they start removing energy subsidies, well, that's another reason why demand will slow down, because people will demand according to the true prices and not subsidized prices. And I'm saying this is probably, it's very complicated politically, it's very charged to increase energy prices, you know, for the overall population, and countries will do it and take it differently. But you know, this is another issue which is under heavy attack, energy subsidies, not only because of finance ministers wanting to reduce the cost of the energy subsidies, but because of all the green movement that is, you know, moving in saying, well, you know, if you want to have green, let's cut subsidies to this kind of fuel, fossil fuels.
Thank you. Sheikh Mohammed?
Well, to the question, why is $80 a threshold? I think there are several points to make. One is Nigerian or Angolan deep water and things like that. And because the gap isn't so big, we can very quickly become back to a place where demand is greater than supply. So if demand had dropped by a greater figure, then yes, I would say we could go lower. But the demand is there. And in addition to what the minister said, I think even going forward, I think oil, you know, the people who predict the demise of oil are you know, to use to paraphrase the quote, are greatly exaggerated, because oil will continue to evolve after China, India. You have Africa. The demand is going to start increasing as countries develop. On the one hand, at the same time, you're going to the uses of oil. You know, the one thing that we haven't found a replacement for oil is in plastics. Over the long run, oil will continue to meet demand, maybe in different forms. Gasoline consumption is dropping, fuel efficiency is increasing, electric cars are increasing, solar panels are helping, and things like that. So where oil is used and how it's used will continue to evolve. But I think that there is core demand going forward, and we will not have a major drop. So, you know, production's on marginal costs, and this, and the traditional oil producers have much lower marginal costs. And so, yes, you're correct, but I think the demand is what is keeping it up, and there's plenty of demand to come going forward on that specific point. Several people mentioned about the nuclear agreement with Iran. Issue, I think, will help reduce prices, because it will probably linked with the removal or easing of sanctions. You know, Boeing just sold spare parts to Iran for the first time in 30 or 40 years. And if Iran can reinvest in its field and have access to modern technology, it will become a global player again without restrictions, and therefore will increase downward pressure on that. So, you know, I may be less optimistic, I guess. Nevertheless, if an agreement happens that leads to easing of sanctions, then I think this will increase the supply or increase downward pressure on global oil prices, obviously.
Memduh?
Thank you. The first one, of course, the Russia-China deal, which, as I was working through this, I didn't get a chance to read, so thank you for that. Now, it of course makes sense. That is what Russia should do, but the feasibility of that is, I think, up for discussion. I mean, having the pipeline through probably the Altai Mountains may not be that easy. So we'll have to look into the investment costs and whether that will be feasible. It may be political posturing. It may be a way of giving a strong political message possible. And even if this materializes, so it does happen, as I said in my remarks, I think this is sort of a race for time. It's, on the one hand, Russia is trying to leverage as much as it can, given still the given the dominance of pipeline trade and its centrality in it. But there is the bigger picture where LNG and shale around the world may be shifting the whole game. So maybe 10, 15 years down the road, even if Russia does get the ability to be a swing state between these two big markets, it may not add up to a very fundamental leverage bargaining power for Russia. So that is actually my reading of the bigger picture. But I do agree that in the short window, if this does materialize, it will give Russia some power, at least for a certain period of time. That's the first thing. The second thing is, a positive resolution, especially because of the recent U.S. elections. I don't know how the U.S. Congress will react to it. I don't know. But let's assume it does. Then, of course, the immediate reaction of the markets, I suspect, would be sanctions. However, this is Saudi Arabia and Russia will obviously need to find ways to react. I cannot predict how Saudi Arabia will react, whether prices go down because it has staying power, it has very huge cash reserves, and it will let the prices go down and let Iran suffer through low prices, possible, I don't know, or whether it will react by cutting off supplies, I really can't predict. I mean, that is something that we'll need to see as we proceed. And again, on the Russian side, which will also suffer if the prices go down after an Iranian deal, one would need to think through how Russia will react not only to the oil prices, but also to the prospect of the giant Iranian gas reserves coming online. Does happen and Iran does join the fossil fuel trade again, this will be a very different game, and we'll need to have hopefully a different panel next year to talk about that here in Delhi. The third point about, is this an economic issue or a political issue? I think basically Saudi Arabia is the key player here, and the question is the Saudi Arabia's decision not to cut supplies an economic or a political choice? Is Saudi Arabia not cutting supplies because it thinks $80 is a good way to have some control over Russia and Iran, especially vis-a-vis their position in Syria? Some say that is the case, I don't know. Or we can argue that it is actually an economically rational decision. It is a strong player that wants to maintain its strength as a market, as a sort of a strong investments in supplies in the US and other places for light, tight oil. So it may just, you may say it's a rational economic choice and approach of a dominant player trying to maintain its dominance. Hard to tell the two apart, so I don't know which way the Saudi Arabia decision makers are thinking. And finally, the substitutes for oil. I do agree it is something we need to look into, especially I think CNG will be a game changer if it takes hold in the US technologically and in terms of infrastructure, because that will short circuit the missing link between natural gas and oil markets fully, and that will be a revolution. In terms of solar, because of the intermittency problem that we all know about, I don't know how it works out in Chile or in Latin America, but the base load supplies of natural gas, nuclear, and coal will still have to be there. So there are limits, upper limits, to how much, with the given technology, we can rely on solar. I was curious, is the 20% of energy from solar, are we talking about power generation or the total primary needs of Chile? Is it 20%?
20% of power generation.
Okay.
Non-conventional passing, we call okay. Central.
Okay,
just
I
the
see.
Passing of.
So we will need to deal with this big problem that in both natural gas and oil markets. And I'll stop there.
Thank you, Memduh. Mr. Mathiswaran, yes.
Thank you, Chair. Quite naturally, the centrality of the entire discussion has been around the energy and the oil and gas part. But I want to flag, particularly my question is pointed to Mr. Philip Larraín. I want to flag the issue of technology and technology dominance in the, with respect to geoeconomics and the availability of commodities trade. You spoke about the super cycle, and I would flag Wallerstein's and quantitative cycle, which tends to talk about dominance of world markets through dominance of technologies. In that context, the technology denial regimes, what is the role that they play, and does it create the emerging markets particularly, does it create more of consumers and feeders of raw materials and human resources to the established technology dominant powers? And is there a skewed geopolitical or geoeconomic balance that continues to be sustained, or will that get balanced out through appropriate measures in the technology denial regimes?
Thank you. Braz Barakui.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sanjaya, for organizing this fascinating panel. What I wanted to perhaps to push a little bit further the geoeconomic dimension you focus a bit on trade, on the trade dimension and prices in your presentation. I wanted to hear a little bit more about the other side of it, which is investment. And particularly focusing on those new geoeconomic powers that are investing in the commodities market. I of course have in mind China. So I wanted to hear a little bit the impacts of your scenario at the end of super cycle to the and the other question, perhaps to Sheikh Al-Khalifa. I remember that perhaps 10 years ago or 15 years ago, the bulk of the discussions on energy security now perhaps the focus shift towards more independence. To push perhaps on your side on the geopolitical dimension of it, I'd like to hear your views on the implication of that definition of energy security for what you defined as West Asia. Thank you.
Thank you, Braz. Dr. Chalia.
Thank you. My question is about why these rentier economies, many of which you, Memduh, mentioned were very fragile and prone to social unrest, why don't they diversify away from dependence on the single products? I mean, if the writing is on the wall, and you said Russia, for example, has a very short window, why don't they see it coming, and why don't they plan in advance? Why are they making these tactical diversifications in terms of markets, as in like selling oil to China rather than Europe? You know, that kind of that's more a tactical diversification. It's not a strategic diversification of their economy as a whole, so that, you know, they can overcome this dependence on the volatility of the commodities markets as a whole, move to manufacturing, move to information technology, move to other sectors. Why don't they do it? And what are the vested interests? If you can give an example of a country which has potentially moved its GDP growth away from commodities and towards non-commodity-based economic production. Thank you.
Right, Ambassador Blackwell.
Thank you, Chairman. I have a question for the panelists and agree that their presentations were excellent. My question is this, if the United States is the winner of these energy developments which you each describe, what is your respective views of the likely effect on American foreign policy of U.S. energy independence?
Right. I'll come back to the panel. Would you like to start off again?
Sure, thank you very much. Very interesting points raised. The first point on technology and emerging markets, I think there are two types of emerging markets. That's one the spread of technology, and I think the ones that are doing this, you know, are having new ways in which to tackle the energy dimension. I mentioned the solar. But let me mention that there is the sea wave, you know, in which, for example, the Scots and the Brits have a lot of experience. There is the wind as several places, and there is the geothermal on top of the solar. So there are several energy sources which have been made commercially available through technological change, and these technologies are spreading. So I think that yes, the emerging markets will come as, you know, as they grow as on the demand side, but these technological changes so far are probably in the oil plus non-oil are probably more important in terms of the overall equilibrium of the balance of the energy market. I would also say that on the renewable energy and non-conventional sources, you were about right, you know, on the issue that yes, we will see increasing substitution, but still fossil fuels will continue to be for some time the main source of energy. So we have to deal with that as an issue. Second point about investments, yes, we have focused about, you know, the trade and the competitive dimensions, but investments, I think the particularly the Chinese have been coming to South America, throughout the world, to try to get, you know, they are very, they're probably being more aggressive in Africa than they have been in South America. If I can give you an example, which is kind of an extreme example, top 10. Right now, China absorbs 25% of Chilean exports, a quarter of all Chilean exports. And, you know, you see after that, Brazil, very substantial, Peru. So if you go in South America, you know, Latin America, you will find that, not so much for the case of Mexico, but in the case of the South America, China is a very important player. But until very recently, you don't have Chinese investments. So this was a big disequilibrium, that China was a big player on trade, but not a big player on investments, with huge accumulation of foreign exchange reserves and surpluses, you know, and they're starting to invest. You know, we had in Chile after a long time, we would say, well, no investments from China. Investment, but, you know, directly on solar energy. So interestingly, you know, on an issue that that is not directly tied to their availability, but on supplying the local market and substituting more expensive sources of energy. On the question about are there any experiences of diversification away from commodities? The tough thing of diversifying away from commodities is that once you have them in place, what do you do? You know, some countries say, well, I have them, you know, but I need to diversify. No, you should use them. And the economics, and I'm sorry to be, you know, although I was in politics for 4 years, you know, I'm deep in here, is a very interesting economic problem. The Dutch disease problem, that you have a huge competitive advantage in one sector, and that provides such a, you know, unbalanced incentive for that sector that you get a real exchange rate appreciation. So it takes away incentives from other tradable sectors. And so that is why it's so difficult to get away. You need to have very, very well-crafted macroeconomic policies to do away with the Dutch disease phenomenon and to get economies diversifying. And you talked about tactical diversification, which is, you know, selling your same stuff but to alternative sources, you know, alternative markets. Well, that's one thing, but you also touched on the issue of how do you diversify away from commodities. I think one of the interesting experiences with a big external event was that of Mexico. If you took Mexico, you know, of export revenue. But that depends a lot on the fact that Mexico got the NAFTA agreement, a free trade agreement with the US in 1994. You know, and then, so all the north of Mexico now is producing goods to sell to the US. And then it diversified away from commodities. And also you got an interesting case of a tiny country, Costa Rica, in Central America, which had Intel investment, and suddenly Costa Rica was not only producing manufacturing goods, it was producing high-tech goods, you know, so and Intel's exports were more than 50% of Costa Rican exports, you know, but those are, it's very tough commodities. There are some cases, but there are not many. But the story is the following. If you take a longer time horizon, all the countries that, not all, but most of the countries that have become developed, they have gone through industrialization, some form of diversifying of their base. The question of whether it's industrialization today or going into services is a different thing, because now services are getting increasingly traded. I guess that's, in terms of a U.S., how will U.S. have a U.S. as self-dependent on, you know, energy sufficient? Well, of course, that, you know, energy and oil will not be such an enormous part of the U.S. interest, and it will start looking at other regions which are not so rich in oil but may have other interests. Particularly, I think Latin America will benefit. Latin America has always been sort of an afterthought for the U.S. in terms of foreign relations, and the dominant issue over the last at least 40 years have been oil. Oil-producing regions and the stability of oil-producing regions, well, this may change at the margin if the U.S. becomes self-sufficient, just because the incentives shift on another direction.
Thank you, Mr. Larraín Bascuñán. Sheikh Mohammed, your closing remarks.
A couple of points. Interdependence versus independence vis-a-vis the U.S. And Saudi and or attributed to Rex Tillerson, the CEO of ExxonMobil, who was speaking to the company and said, we're no longer an oil company, we're an energy company. We're investing in solar, we're investing in gas, and went on to describe that, and then at the end came back and said, but don't forget, we are an oil company. It the same thing. You could interdependent, and it's no longer just the U.S. And view it from a greater scale. And if and so you, the world is more interdependent and more global. So it's no longer an issue, but at the same time, nobody can deny that the U.S. is still the strongest, most powerful country in the world. So you must maintain that relationship. So it's not as crucial, but it's still important. And therefore, I think you can view it as it's more global interdependence. And the U.S., and this leads into Ambassador Blackwell's point on U.S. foreign policy. What I would add is there's a lot of domestic pressure for the U.S. to look inwards, and you see it today with the reluctance to send troops and the U.S. So that plays and gives any U.S. president the excuse not to get involved and to reduce U.S. involvement, let's say, especially military involvement overseas. But I still think we need U.S. foreign policy to play an important role. But as we've seen with Ukraine and other places, any foreign policy must be backed up, or if the threat or the use of force is not there as a backstop, nobody's going to listen to what you say. So if the U.S. isn't going to use its military, then its foreign policy will become less effective. So it is, and the world will become more dangerous and less stable. I think the U.S., whether it likes it or not, remains, plays a role as being one of the global policemen. And the U.S. today, especially after the Cold War, is trying to get rid of that responsibility, but I don't think the U.S. has that choice. all domestic, all politics are local, and it comes down to U.S. domestic politics. And so I'm not too optimistic. Let me put it that way. But I'd like to see a more engaged U.S. But I'm being realistic and say I don't think we will get much of it going forward, especially if the U.S. becomes more energy independent for the coming 5-10 years. Just one last point on the diversification away from commodities. An interesting case study is the Gulf, Bahrain, the UAE, and others. Today, oil is an ever-reducing part of our economies. Oil probably is I know it is in Bahrain, it's about 2% of employment. It's about 5% of employment in the UAE and other places, and less than 20% of GDP. It's still a significant portion of government revenue. And as Felipe mentioned, the issue is industrialization. You know, will you move to industrialization and create a tax system, which is the last step we haven't done. But in terms of everyday lives, we've actually diversified away from oil. Oil doesn't impact. The only people who are worried about oil are maybe the ministers of finance and the treasury, but we are well on the way to diversifying away from oil, but we haven't achieved it. Getting rid of the Dutch disease and moving away will be a difficult challenge, because as people have tried, you still can't, at least I can speak for Bahrain, we haven't been able to. And I think I'll stop there.
Thank you. Memduh, two minutes?
2 minutes. About diversification, that question, I think it has been addressed, but let me just add one thing. On top of the Dutch disease, in many of these countries, you have to add another economics term, hysteresis, path dependence, call it what you may, is ladder of value added. And that, of course, deters FDI into these countries, so it creates this vicious cycle. It will take a big policy push to come over that big barrier that has built over time. So that's the first thing. It's not a positive message. On the, in responding to the ambassador on U.S. policy, the easy answer could be saying, well, the U.S. can't really remove itself from energy issues around the globe to defend its European allies and to have some control over its potential rivals around the globe. But I think it seems to be a bit more complicated than that. The way I see things evolving, especially in my part of the world, the US is trying to do two things. One is to extricate itself from regional conflicts to focus on the broader global threats because of its own constraints in terms of ability. Two, trying to actually shift some of the burden of regional crises to the emerging big powers like China, potentially India. So to do that, of course, this won't be easy because everybody is quite happy with putting the burden on the US in some sense. So it's a war of attrition. This will play out, and I don't think it'll be easy. I think what we are seeing in the Middle East, in our neighborhood, is actually a reflection of that war of attrition. Now, the fact that the US feels more comfortable about its access to energy will probably give it more leeway and ability to prolong that war of attrition and establish a new equilibrium in who carries the burden in regional crises. If I carry that forward, so that's sort of the near, 5 to 10 years, but if I carry that forward, I have a fear going maybe 15, 20 years, that if the US plays that path a bit too much, what we may end up having is a regionalization of oil trade, because if the US feels that hemispherically, here is sufficient in terms of energy. Outcome, but it is something that I'm watching. I think it may happen within my lifetime. So that would be my fear in the 15 to 20 year horizon. And I'll stop there.
Thank you, Memduh. Those of you who fought your Monday morning itis and were able to come here on time and sit through this session will agree with me that our three panelists deserve a standing ovation. But thank you very much. We have just about caught up with time. We will take a coffee break and meet again here at 11:30. I have just two announcements on the geoeconomics of global pharmaceuticals from 3 to 4:30 after lunch. Those of you who would like to attend that session, it will be helpful if you can just inform our registration desk, but you're most welcome to attend that session. And it will be in the Chaitya Hall, which is in the basement of this hotel. The second announcement, of course, is that we meet here at 11:30. I just want to take half a minute and mention that one of the unique things that the International Institute of Strategic Studies has brought to the discourse on international affairs and strategic policy is to recognize the role of the private sector in international affairs. John Chipman, the Director General of the IISS, has written and spoken about the importance of corporate foreign policy. That companies too, it's not just governments, but that companies too have foreign policy. And we have, in the geoeconomics program, focused on the role of the private sector globally and regionally in influencing national governments and in developing their own foreign policies. So our next session is really devoted to this very specialized interest of the IISS. And we have two tall corporate leaders from India participating in that session. So please have your coffee and come back on time. Thank you.